Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into the LakersNation.com podcast. I am Trevor Lane, and it's game day. Lakers, Grizzlies tonight, the penultimate game of the season. The Lakers badly need to get this win to have a shot, at least some kind of a chance, to move out of the dreaded 9-10 matchup in the play-in tournament. We actually had some things go the Lakers' way last night. One of the things I'm going to get into on this show is what needs to happen from here in order for the Lakers to move up potentially to the 8th seed, maybe the 7th seed. That's pretty unlikely, but what needs to take place in order for the Lakers to move up? I'm going to get into that. We're going to talk a bit about this Lakers-Grizzlies matchup, and of course, we'll get into the mailbag as well. But first, here's a quick look at the injury report as it currently stands. The Lakers list Anthony Davis as probable. Great news there. He was not a go, was dealing with nausea and a headache, whether that was illness, whether that was eye injury related. He's listed as left eye contusion on the injury report here, but he is probable to play tonight against the Grizzlies. LeBron James, questionable to play for this one, but I mean, this is par for the course for the Lakers throughout the season. LeBron typically listed as questionable. Anthony Davis, either probable or questionable. I would be shocked if these guys don't play tonight in Memphis. Jalen Uchifino, Jared Vanderbilt, Christian Wood all out. Still waiting on more word on Jared Vanderbilt. Hopefully we hear something, get some kind of info tonight on what's going on with Jared Vanderbilt. We'll see if we hear anything from Darvin Ham on that one today. But the big thing, let's take a look at the standings. There it is, the Lakers dropping to 10th now with the Warriors. Boy, they almost lost. There was for a few minutes there, we thought, oh, wow, this could really happen. They were playing the Blazers, which is typically a gimme win. It was close late, and then the Warriors pulled away at the end. That would have been a gift had the Warriors found a way, because they tempted the basketball gods. They sat Klay and Draymond against the Blazers to rest them up for tonight's matchup with the New Orleans Pelicans. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. They tempted fate there, and somehow, just barely, they squeaked by and got the win. It looked like for a little bit that the Blazers might actually get it done. That would have been, oh, what a great night that would have been had the Blazers managed to beat the Warriors. But we did see the New Orleans Pelicans beat the Sacramento Kings, which is something the Lakers needed. So what you've got right now is a three-way tie between the Kings, the Warriors, and the Lakers. The Lakers do not have the tiebreaker over either the Kings or the Warriors, so you know automatically they're going to slot last in that grouping, and that's going to put them in the 10 seed. Now, as things currently stand right now, we would have Lakers, Warriors, with the Lakers on the road in the 9-10 matchup in the play-in tournament. Not ideal. Tying with the Kings, tying with the Warriors, it's death for the Lakers because they do not have the tiebreaker against either team. So that's not good. What we want to see happen is the Lakers ideally move up to the 8th seed. And that actually could happen. That could get set into motion tonight. Two things need to occur in order for that to happen, in order for the Lakers to move up to 8th. Two things need to happen. Number one, the Pelicans need to beat the Warriors. That needs to happen. The Pelicans beat the Warriors. That puts the Warriors, again, we focus on the loss column this time of year. That puts the Warriors at 36 losses. If the Lakers win out, that would mean they would finish with 35 losses. They would be ahead of the Warriors. So that's one thing we need to see happen. And then we would need to see the Phoenix Suns beat the Sacramento Kings. Again, getting the Kings to 36 losses. That would put the Lakers, should they beat Memphis tonight, that would put the Lakers up into the 8th seed. That's double elimination territory. And then should the Lakers beat the Pelicans in the final game of the season in that scenario, that would lock in at least that 8th seed for the Lakers. Now, New Orleans could very well have some stuff on the line. They could have the 6th seed on the line in the final game of the season. We already got word from Chris Haynes that Brandon Ingram, our old friend, of course, is going to return to play the Lakers on Sunday. He will return for the Pelicans in order to play against the Lakers. He's been out for weeks, and he's going to come back just to play the Lakers. In fact, it was kind of funny. Underdog actually put out on over on X in their tweet of the injury update from Chris Haynes. It said, Brandon Ingram, knee injury / saw Lakers on the calendar, is returning on Sunday per Chris Haynes. Pretty, everybody seems to come back just to play the Lakers. So that's what the Lakers are going to be faced with on Sunday against the Pelicans. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean the Lakers are completely out of the ability to move up. It doesn't. There is another path. So let's say that the Pelicans beat the Warriors. That's the key. The Pelicans have to beat the Warriors. And the Pelicans are coming off second night of back-to-back. Warriors are coming off second night of back-to-back. It's on the road. It's in Golden State. The Warriors rested Klay, rested Draymond to be ready for the Pelicans. None of that bodes well for the Lakers. Now, another possibility would be the Suns lose to the Sacramento Kings and then lose to the Minnesota Timberwolves. That could pull them into a tie with the Lakers, in which case the Lakers would move ahead because they do have the tiebreaker over the Suns. That could be a potential factor in all of this. But again, if they get into, say, a three-way tie where like Sacramento is involved or Golden State is involved, that gets much more convoluted. So the easiest way to look at this is Pelicans have to beat the Warriors tomorrow. If that happens and you can get a Kings loss to Phoenix, that sets the Lakers up to potentially claim that 8 seed. So something definitely to keep an eye on there. Now, is it likely that all this is going to happen? No. I mean, I look at it this way. If at least the Pelicans can beat the Warriors, that sets the Lakers up to, at worst, be the 9 seed. That's really the key. That's the linchpin to all of this, is the Pelicans need to beat the Warriors. If the Pelicans don't beat the Warriors, the Lakers are probably going to finish tied with them because the Warriors play Utah in the final game of the season. And that's best case because the Lakers still have to beat the Pelicans to finish things out. It's going to be tough. So it's really important that the Pelicans beat the Warriors and then that some other things fall into place from there. Ideally, the Kings lose to the Suns, and that gives the Lakers a chance to move ahead. So it's not great. Look, let's be honest. It's not great, the situation that the Lakers are in right now. It's not ideal. You have to rely on certain things happening. Them winning out doesn't guarantee anything. In fact, they could win out and still be the 10 seed. Like, that's very possible. They could win all their games and still wind up being the 10 seed. So not good. Not good, but there is still a chance for them to move up to 8. I believe this is a scenario where they can even move up to 7, but it's very unlikely. It's unlikely that you're going to get all that stuff to happen. The key to watch for tonight, do the Pelicans beat the Warriors? If not, you're probably not passing them. This is probably your last shot at passing the Warriors. It's the game with the Pelicans and Golden State, because I don't trust that Utah is going to beat the Warriors. It's not going to happen. And then Sacramento. If Sacramento can lose to Phoenix, that gives you the chance to at least move ahead of them. If, let's say, one of those things, let's say it's just Sacramento losing to Phoenix, that would still give you a chance to at least move ahead of the Kings, and that would potentially bump the Warriors up, and then you'd be playing against the Kings in the play-in tournament, but you'd be at home. So there's that factor too. Again, there's a lot of ways that this could still shift, but to me, the linchpin, it's Pelicans, Warriors. You want the Warriors to lose that game. And ideally, you'd like the Sacramento Kings to lose to the Suns. That's the easiest way to go through all this. So once again, my brain is melted at this point from having gone through all of these scenarios for the last like couple of weeks. But the bottom line, the Lakers can lose again. They can't lose. They can't lose tonight in Memphis. They can't lose on Sunday in New Orleans. And again, there actually could be a lot on the line Sunday in New Orleans for both the Pelicans and the Lakers, depending on how things play out. Okay, so all that being said, Lakers Grizzlies tonight. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. The Lakers have to win. The Lakers have to win. There's no getting around it. Nothing else. That said, the Lakers better win. They better win. Look, the Grizzlies have shut down. They're already missing John Morant. They've shut down Jaren Jackson Jr. They've shut down Desmond Bane. Their seasons are over. So you're playing an extremely depleted Grizzlies side. In fact, I'm checking right now. As of this moment, the Lakers are a 15.5-point favorite. That's the same as Boston was the favorite when the Lakers were playing Boston in Boston without AD and LeBron. And we know how that one ended up. So I'm not, hopefully that's not bad luck there, but that's an extremely heavy favorite. The Lakers are an extremely, that is one of the most lopsided lines you're going to see of the season. By the way, Golden State is a 4.5-point favorite right now over the Pelicans, just taking a peek, and Phoenix is a 5.5-point favorite over the Kings. So maybe you can get some movement there. But the Lakers are a very heavy favorite here. LeBron and AD, I believe everyone assumes they're going to play. And look, do the Grizzlies have a few guys that could hurt you? Yeah. Are they going to play loose because they've got nothing to lose? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Jake LaRavia went nuts from deep last game for the Memphis Grizzlies. You never know, right, with these games. But the Lakers, they should get out there, take care of business, give themselves a chance, and then we'll see. We'll see what happens with Warriors Pelicans. We'll see what happens with Sacramento and Phoenix, and then that'll set up Sunday, and that will inform us of what needs to happen on Sunday, what the Lakers are going to do there Sunday afternoon when they play against the Pelicans to close out the season, and then they'll get ready for the play-in tournament. They're in the play-in tournament no matter what, but the hope right now has to be that you can get your way into the 7-8 matchup somehow, some way, because if that happens, I'm projecting right now Denver is going to finish as the one seed. I think that's pretty certain that's what's going to happen here. So if you can get into the 7-8 matchup, and you can win that first game, you can avoid Denver in round one. If you're in 9-10, the best outcome is you're the 8th seed. And that means you're going up against Denver in round one. So a lot on the line still. A lot of important stuff that needs to happen here. And we'll see if the basketball gods smile upon the Lakers and they can get out of this 9-10 matchup. All right, I do want to get into the mailbag a bit here. Let's see. This one says, these refs, talking about the game against the Warriors, we're not calling any fouls. Hopefully the Kings can drop a couple of their next games and give the Lakers a chance to get the 8th seed. For sure. You know, Adam Silver actually talked about this recently after the Board of Governors meeting, where he talked about the way the game's being officiated. It's actually changed. They've shifted the way this game is called now in order to have fewer free throws. I believe Silver said there's an average of two less free throws per game now, two less trips to the line per game. The NBA wanted to get rid of some of these stoppages, some of the slowdowns, some of the foul baiting that we're seeing. And I think it's a positive. I mean, honestly, I think it hurts the Lakers because the Lakers are a team that is very disciplined at defending without fouling. And they're also a team that draws a lot of fouls. They prioritize cutting to the basket and getting buckets at the rim over three-point shooting. They're one of the lowest volume three-point shooting teams in the NBA, despite shooting the three very well this season. So that does hurt the Lakers, because they're a team that would prefer to see more whistles, because they tend to come out on the plus side of that. And that is not the league rigging things for the Lakers. And all you have to do is watch the games and you can see what's happening. The Lakers tend to give up open jumpers, which do not yield fouls, and they tend to not take jumpers themselves. They tend to try to get to the rim, sometimes by drive, but typically by the pass into the paint. But that said, I think for the NBA as a whole, it's better this way. It's better watching games where they allow a little bit more contact, let the game be a little more physical, for crying out loud. Dennis said AD needs to wear goggles. I haven't heard anything about him wearing goggles. I've seen the suggestion quite a bit. I would imagine he's probably not going to, though. Because it's especially this late in the season, like, that's a tough thing to adjust to. If he does, I hope it works out for him. But I'd be kind of surprised at this point. Kudos to Ham for not using Max and for calling a timeout. Down 18 with 1:26 to go. And Rui for eating all those blocks. Rui did get blocked quite a bit. But yeah, you know, you bring up a great point. Against the Warriors, what, like, I really wonder, was Darvin trolling us? Was Darvin Ham trolling Lakers fans? I really, like, my head says no. My head says there's no chance. There's no way Darvin Ham was trolling Lakers fans when the Lakers were down big. There's a minute 26 to go, and he calls a timeout. You know what I mean? Like, my head says, no, there's no way he was really doing that. But maybe, right? Like part of me has to think, what if Darvin, in a blowout loss, is just like, oh, you guys think I never use timeouts? I'll show you timeout. And calls it with 1-2 just to mess with everybody. Just, it's not realistic at all. But the thought occurred to me in that moment, because God, it made no sense calling that timeout. It made no sense. And we've been saying all year, that he doesn't use his timeouts enough. And so there, the game's over. He calls timeout. Oh, Darvin. Trey. Damn, Trey. said the Lakers are still ninth, but Darvin needs to be diagnosed with a mental disability. Oh, man, this was a winnable game. AD LeBron, of course, getting the unhealthy at the worst time. Yeah, I mean, was it a winnable game? The Warriors hit, what, 26 threes, I believe, and they shot a, and I talked about this last show, against the Lakers, the Warriors set an NBA record, all-time NBA record, for three-point percentage with 40 or more attempts ever in all of NBA history. 3,400 games it's happened. 3,400 games have been played where a team has shot 40 or more threes. 3,400. And the Warriors just shot the highest percentage of any of them. So when we say that's a winnable game, I don't know how winnable it was. If the Warriors shot that well, if the Warriors shot 40% from three, hell yeah, it's winnable. It's definitely winnable. And 40% from three is a good shooting night. It's a really good shooting night. 64% though, you set an NBA record? That's crazy. And by the way, in the media notes that I just got recently for the Lakers game against the Grizzlies tonight, it noted one of the notes from Memphis in there was that the Grizzlies, early on in the season, they hit 23 threes against the Lakers on the road in L.A. That was that game, remember? It was just Draymond Green that was hitting all the threes. Remember the game Marcus Smart was hitting all the threes? Remember, the Lakers' scheme is to allow certain players to shoot shots, and if those players happen to hit shots, they often lose. We saw it with Dante Exum. We saw it with Draymond Green against the Warriors. Marcus Smart for the Grizzlies did it, and the Grizzlies had a franchise road record. On the road, they've never hit that many threes before, ever, in their entire history of their franchise. 23 threes on the road against the Lakers. So when we talk about teams setting records against the Lakers, particularly from deep, the Warriors set the all-time record for three-point percentage with 40 or more attempts, and the Grizzlies set a franchise record for a number of threes on the road. Both those things happening this season. And again, that's the Lakers' defensive scheme, where they decide, hey, we're going to make that guy the shooter. And if whoever that guy is happens to knock down those shots, they probably lose. That's their defensive scheme. This one says, there's no way Ham can keep his job for the simple fact that Bron and AD both played 70-plus games and we will finish 10th. That's the downside, right? Like, you can look at it that way. I mean, I guess that's the glass is half empty, right? Darvin Ham had LeBron and AD for much of the season. This team was built to withstand playing without LeBron. That's how the team, you look at the wing depth, that's how this team was put together. But they had these guys for most of the season. LeBron and AD have been remarkably healthy. Obviously, the recent games excluded. They've been remarkably healthy, and you're still going to be 10th. Now, that said, you've won more games than you did last season. I know a good chunk of last season was you had a Russell Westbrook size anchor holding you back, but still, you've won more games than you did last season. You're well above 500. The context of a ridiculous Western Conference is real. I mean, again, the Lakers are, I think record wise, they'd still be the four seed right now if their record is what it is right now, but it was last season. So you got to factor that in too. Plus, while LeBron and AD have been healthy, no one else has. Everyone else has been varying degrees of ridiculously injured, from Gabe Vincent missing almost the entire season, Jared Vanderbilt missing the vast majority of the season. He's still out right now. Everybody, Rui Hachimura has been in and out of the lineups. Everybody's been hurt. Everybody. So the Lakers have been one of the most injured teams in the NBA this season. People just don't think of that because it's mostly not been LeBron and AD, but they've been one of the teams that have lost more man games due to injury, more games available due to injury than any other team in the league. So all of that, and by the way, in no way is any of that me saying that Ham should keep his job. I'm just saying, if you just look at that one thing and you say AD and LeBron played 70 plus games and you're still the 10 seed. Yeah, that's true. That's factually correct. But there's context to that too. The ridiculous West, where the records are all totally skewed compared to what's normal, where the record that normally would have you probably with home court advantage in the first round, now is a 10 seed. Like, that's a huge difference. And then everybody else being hurt. That's not named LeBron and AD. Alicia, what a sad day to be a fan. Sad to even watch. I'll tell you what, guys. This is the tough thing for Lakers fans, right? Is that every big game the Lakers have had, they've lost since the All-Star break. Every time we've said this is a big game, like direct, you're playing the Kings, playing the Suns, you're playing the Warriors, direct Western Conference opponents, they've lost. They've lost. And so all the games where fans got really keyed up, really let's go, fired up, we're going to find a way, we're going to overcome, we're going to get the win, you get a punch in the gut. That's what we've seen. When it's, you're playing Memphis, you're playing the Wizards, okay, yeah, we're going to win that game. You're playing Philly without Embiid, no problem, you're going to win that game. And they've had some uplifting wins. The Bucks game, double overtime, that was impressive. Right? I'm not saying they haven't, but the six really big, these games matter for the standings because you need to knock your opponent down a little bit as well as lift yourself up. Every single one of those games since the All-Star break, they've dropped. Every single one of them. And you go and you look at the standings right now, and you see who are the three teams right ahead of the Lakers. It's the Warriors, it's the Kings, it's the Suns. The exact three teams that you've dropped your games to. The exact ones. Imagine how different this all looks if the Lakers had gone 500 in those games. Let's say they put a loss on each one of them. Let's say they won one game against, of those six games, let's say they won one game against the Warriors, one game against the Kings, one game against the Suns. What does that put the Lakers at right now? That puts the Lakers with 32 losses right now. They'd be 48 and 32. They'd be tied with New Orleans right now. As of this moment, the Lakers have the tiebreaker over the Pelicans. They'd be the sixth seed right now. Had they just played 500 basketball in those games against their direct competitors, they'd be the sixth seed right now with Sunday's game against New Orleans likely deciding it. Meanwhile, you would add one more loss to each one of these opponents, so the Phoenix Suns would still be in the play-in. They'd be the eight seed, slide everybody down one spot, right? If you just go 500, just play 500 basketball in those six games. And I know we can play the what-if game forever, but when you get comments like this saying, what a sad day to be a fan, sad to watch, I think it's because those games that we knew mattered so much. Because it's not just about putting the win on your record. It's about putting a loss on your opponent's record. The one that you're directly competing with. You did the opposite. You pushed a win on your opponent's record. Took a loss yourself. I mean, you guys see how damaging it is. It's the difference between the 10 seed and the 6 seed right now. Hart said, name one time where Ham's coaching made a difference. I mean, look, I've piled on Darvin Ham. I had a bunch of stuff on X the other day. And yesterday's show, I talked about just the madness of Darvin Ham's rotations over the course of the season and how much they cost the Lakers. But it's also not honest to say that it's all on Darvin Ham. It's not. Has he messed up this season? Sure. Plenty. But there's a lot else that's taken place too. And by no means is that me saying take blame off of Darvin. Right? I talked about this last season. I talked about the season before. I talked about the season before that. We talked about it in relation to Russell Westbrook. We talked about it in relation to Frank Vogel. A lot of things have to go wrong for an NBA team to have a bad season or to have a rough season or just to have a season. Just the nature of a professional sports season, you're going to have things go wrong. So almost certainly, if you're going to take the blame pie and put 100% of it at the feet of one thing, it's not correct. It's not correct. It's not all Darvin's fault. It's not. It's not all LeBron's fault. It's not all AD's fault. It's not all the front office's fault. It's not all the schedule's fault. It's not all the injuries' fault. Is there blame to all of those things? Yes. Sure. There's plenty of blame to go around. And does Darvin deserve a big piece of it? Yeah. I agree with that. But we also can get caught in this mindset. And again, I just went on a big rant on yesterday's show and on X, explaining how maddening Darvin Ham's decision-making was and what a big gamble he took going against the grain with some of the rotations that he used, some of the lineups that he used that didn't work out. These are things that we look at now. These are things we look back on now. Was there method to the madness in the moment? Sometimes, yeah. Sometimes, yeah, there was. But ultimately, he chose to give minutes and a role to certain archetypes rather than the most skilled players, rather than the players that were paid the most, players that were paid to be starters. He instead gave minutes and rotation spots to guys who were paid to be bench players. It was a big gamble. It didn't pay off. But to say that Darvin hasn't done anything this season is also not correct. Specifically, when we talk about Ham's coaching, I like a lot of the wrinkles the Lakers have thrown in on the offensive end lately. The cuts we've seen from them. How many times a game do we see D'Angelo Russell suddenly slither free and get a layup off of a nice cut and he gets found by LeBron? How many times have we now seen them take advantage of the baseline cuts for dunks for guys like Rui Hachimura and Jackson Hayes? We've seen, I think, some solid wrinkles on the offensive end. So I don't think it's fair to say Darvin Ham made no positive impact whatsoever. Because even as much as you may despise Darvin Ham at this point, that's not fair. That's not accurate. I guess it's fair if you just really dislike him that much, but it's not accurate. It's not true. It's not that he's done nothing. So, all right, Buck. And again, that's not me saying. And here's the thing, right? Here's the thing with all this is that we can talk all about Darvin Ham having struggles and all that kind of stuff. The second it's anything else, it's going to get dismissed as an excuse, right? Like the second you say the Warriors shot a historic percentage from three, excuses. No, that's a fact. That's what happened, right? The second you say this team's been one of the most injured teams of the season, oh, excuses. It's Darvin's fault. No, that's a fact. That's what happened. Second, you say the Lakers had the, I believe, second most back-to-backs of any team in the NBA this season. Excuses. No, that's a fact. That's context. That's part of what matters over the course of the season. And once again, I'm not trying to deflect blame from Darvin Ham or take away from that. Just if we're taking a whole look at the season, where did things go wrong? Just focusing all the attention on Darvin Ham, it's not accurate. It's not accurate. And you can't just dismiss anything that's not, I'm angry at Darvin Ham, as an excuse. It's not the way it works. It's not honest analysis. And again, I'm the guy that just went on a big rant on X. The tweets are still blowing up. People are still firing off their comments on him, explaining where Darvin Ham went wrong with the rotation. Again, not saying the dude did a good job. Not saying that. But it's also not all on him. There's other stuff that happened too. D'Lo's defense will void his check this offseason. I think a lot of it's going to depend on how he plays in the postseason. You know, I was thinking about this actually. I kind of wonder for D'Angelo Russell, just for D'Lo, not speaking for the team, would it be better if they don't make the playoffs? You know what I'm saying? Like, would it be better if they don't make the playoffs for D'Lo specifically? Because he's had a great season. He's turned in a great season at this point. His numbers are fantastic. They're great. He should be getting a decent raise. He should be getting a long-term deal this summer. The playoffs could cement that. But last year, the playoffs took away a lot of money, I think, from D'Lo in free agency. So if you're D'Angelo Russell, you've already done the work. You've put it on film. The playoff question will still be hanging over your head, but you can't look at it and say, oh, it's D'Angelo Russell's fault that they didn't get to the playoffs. So if they were to go into the play-in and not survive it, would that actually benefit D'Angelo Russell more than maybe seeing Denver in round one would, and where a series where he's almost certain to get targeted? Could that actually set him back in terms of his next contract? It's a thought that occurred to me. Hopefully it's not a thought that's occurred to D'Lo. Jerry King, we haven't been the Lakers in a while. What happened to aspiring for greatness? Instead, we have to settle for the play-in for 2 years. Where's our pride? They're well above 500. Again, I look at the context of the West. Now, your point being that the bar is high for the Lakers because it's the Lakers and all that. You're absolutely right. Look, you're absolutely right. The bar is high for the Lakers, and they set that bar high with a long history of greatness. So by no means do I say that you're wrong in that. But this year, I think the play-in situation is a bit different than a typical year. It's not like they are a 35-win team that somehow squeaked into the playoffs, a.k.a. they play in the East. Rather, that's not what's happening here. The West is insane, and it's going to be worse, I think, next year. So, and by worse, I mean it's going to be more difficult next year. But that said, yeah, look, when we're looking back at what the LeBron era was with the Lakers, one title, what I think could have been a back-to-back championship run that was derailed by an injury to Anthony Davis in round one against that in 2021, I think the Lakers definitely would have survived the Suns, would have gotten past the Suns, had no answer to AD, would have gotten past the Suns and probably would have gotten to the finals that year had AD not got hurt in round one. And then who knows what happens. I mean, then we're talking about no Russell Westbrook trade and my gosh, I want to live in that timeline. But you've also seen the Lakers not make the playoffs with LeBron on the roster. You've seen the play-in tournament. You've seen them make the Western Conference Finals. Is it underwhelming? That's going to be a bigger conversation for the summer. Super dope hip-hop. Oh, boy. D'Lo, recent games versus Minnesota, Golden State, Sacramento, Pacers, 28% from the field, 26% from three. Lakers 0-6 in those games. Bench dominated again against Golden State. The Lakers bench got dominated. Yeah. That's going to be what's going to hang over D'Lo's head. Again, he's had a great season. But if the perception is that he can't play well in the big games, specifically against teams, you look at those are all teams that have bigger defenders they could send at D'Lo that can potentially give him problems. Is that going to hang over him? Is that going to perhaps take away his ability to earn some money in free agency or to get a big bump in free agency? That's maybe something that we'll have to look at. But again, that's true that he struggled in those games. I think it's also fair to say that he's been more consistent than he has in the past this season, and he's had a really good season for the Lakers. I think both those things are true. Nelson, that fool of a coach needs to be fired. Heavy G said, it's my birthday. All I wanted was a Lakers win. Feels bad. Sorry about that. Happy birthday anyway. D'Lo's best when games aren't important and can take a pro-am style threes. Hope they don't waste $30 million a year on D'Lo. I don't think he's getting $30 million. And re-sign Spencer Dinwiddie instead, saving money for a third star. Well, that doesn't actually save you any money. Lakers are so far over the cap that even not bringing back D'Lo doesn't mean they suddenly have spending power. They could not bring back LeBron and not really have spending power. That's how far over the cap they are, which is going to be a much bigger conversation that we're going to look at this summer. If the Lakers cared about LeBron, they would have Ty Lue, Caruso, Kyrie, or DeMar DeRozan. God, I mean, they've made a lot of mistakes. Letting Caruso, I mean, the big one is the Russell Westbrook trade. That's the big one. I mean, that's the massive mistake. But then Caruso, yeah. Ty Lue not bringing him in, yeah. Although Frank Vogel did win a championship. Kyrie, could they have gotten Kyrie? The Nets seem pretty determined not to give him to the Lakers because that's where Kyrie wanted to go. But DeRozan, yeah. They could have had DeRozan. They chose Russ. Alicia Green, that's a hell of a ball club over there. Oh my gosh, Darvin Ham. What was it Darvin Ham said? It was one of the Darvinisms. It was nobody's going to feel sorry for us. I just don't want to hear that stuff. Super dope hip hop said Draymond Green started 5 from 5 from 3 in game 7 of the 2016 finals. Oh, okay. I didn't realize that, but that's 8 years ago now. Crazy. Ham, D'Lo, and AD need to go? Mad at AD? That's what Alex says. Ronnie says, all of this doesn't matter if AD isn't back. Well, he's back. He's going to play tonight against Grizzlies. Would you take your time with AD to have him healthy for the play-in? I think he's going to be okay. And I think the Lakers need to do everything they can to get the hell out of the 9-10 seed. And again, they can't do it. They need other stuff to happen for them now. But you got to win their games. Obviously, it doesn't happen if they don't win. They have to win their games. Jay Hoodie, not going to lie, I feel like they should just miss the playoffs because they're going to be so burnt out if they get there. Fire him and retool, not Star Chase. Okay, so I've seen that. I've seen this sentiment from a few fans saying, what's the point? Why even bother going to the playoffs? They're just going to get, you know, they're going to wind up in the 9-10. Even if they've survived that, you just get Denver in round one and you lose anyway. Okay, so why even bother? Why go? First of all, you never know what's going to happen in sports. Is it a daunting hill to climb? Yes, it absolutely is. But everybody should want to compete, especially when you have LeBron and AD on your team. Is there a great chance that they're going to survive, say, on the road at Golden State, on the road at Sacramento, let's say, in the second round of the play-in, and then Denver in round one? Is it a great chance that they're going to survive that? No. No, it's not. But that doesn't mean you just want to throw your hands up and go, oh, no, probably not going to happen. I quit. No. That path is too hard. I quit. Not going to do it. I quit. I'll be honest. I hate that mentality. And that's nothing on Jay Hoodie. That's not me taking any kind of a shot or speaking ill, because I've seen this mentality. It's more, it reminds me of something. When I was teaching and when I was coaching, I would coach these teams, and this was, we'd be putting these teams together. And I taught junior high. There were some junior high teams that I would coach. And what would happen is we were at one of the smaller schools in the area. So that meant that, for example, if I was coaching soccer, if one of our neighboring schools had, I don't know, if they would have double the population. So if they had 10 club soccer players, who that's what they do year round, they play soccer, right? They had 10 club soccer players on their roster for their team. That meant I would have at most 5, right? And then I'm trying to teach kids, coach them, and figure out a way to, you know, bridge that gap, find kids who are just athletes and I can teach them how to play soccer and that kind of stuff. That's what we're doing. Same thing with basketball. Same thing with any of the other sports. Same thing. So we were definitely not guaranteed to win anything. But I had a number of teams where the kids at this point, if they realized that they weren't going to win, that they didn't have a chance to win the championship that year, I had kids who would say, well, I'm not going to play. I had that happen with a number of actually fairly talented players. Say, well, yeah, but we're not going to. The reason why was they didn't want to hear about it from their friends, from their peers around school when they lost, if they lost, because that was a bigger deal than winning was, right? They didn't want to hear about the negativity around losing, the stigma around losing. If they knew that, hey, there's a bunch of teams that we're playing against that are stacked, and while we can be okay, we probably don't have a great shot of winning. I would have kids who would say, well, no, I'm not going to play this season then. I had kids who once, I had one season, the basketball season I coached, our best player, about a month before the season started, he broke his arm, and he broke it bad enough to where he was going to be out for the season. I mean, it cast all the way up his elbow and all that stuff. He was going to be out for the season. When that happened, my top four player, he was number one. My three other top four players all said, we're not going to play. All of them said, no, we're not going to play. Why? Because we don't have a great shot to win without our guy here. So that attitude of, well, we don't have a great chance, so why even go anyway? That bothers me on a personal level. Because of that experience, I was so disappointed in my athletes at that point that they would have that mindset. It bothered me. And so when I see, well, we're probably not going to win. So what's the point? No, who cares if it's too hard? You always want the chance. You always want the opportunity. You want the possibility of success. if you lose, you lose. But at least you give it your best. At least you go out there and you compete. You don't just throw your hands up and say, oh, well, no, it's too hard. Not going to do it. Not worth even trying. No, be competitive. Toughen up a little bit, right? And on top of that, from a franchise level, from an organizational level, if you get any home games you get is more revenue. Games played equals revenue coming in. And even from a fan perspective, you want the team to make as much money as possible so they'll feel more emboldened to spend money this summer. So from an organizational perspective, there's a lot of money on the line too with going farther into the postseason. Not to mention, what's your reputation around the league? Do other players who you might want to go trade for and things like that see you as a team that's really good and really, and you've just made a great run and you're really close to being something? That's a positive too. So again, I don't look at it and say, well, they could get swept in round one by Denver again. And if that happens, oh, there's going to be so much negativity around the Lakers. I don't even want that to be a possibility. I'd rather just don't make the playoffs. No, give me the chance. Give me the chance. If they get swept, they get swept. But you go out on your shield. You don't run away from it. Sports dogma. Lakers net rating fell from top 10 to bottom 20 in one game. It can't be for the season. I'd have to go look and see that number. Vader says they're cooked, tired of mediocrity. Do you really think we could win two games in the play-in? Yeah, I think they could. I mean, you've got LeBron, you got AD. You've got one of the best offenses in the NBA since the All-Star break. I think it's possible. Big Sean said, is it possible to get the 8th seed? Yes, it is. And I went over that at the beginning of the show. And Jarrell, LeBron sitting against the Warriors and AD getting hit by the Warriors, came back to bite, should have won both games. Farewell, Darvin Ham. Yeah, I mean, this is the time of year when we look back. Should have, what if, all of that. But there's still basketball to be played. At the very least, the Lakers have three more games. At the least. Got tonight, got Sunday, and you have a play-in game. That's at a minimum. It could go a lot longer. Could go three games, could go more. We'll see. And we'll see. Are they in double elimination for the play-in? Single elimination? What's that look like? We find out. But everybody, I want to thank you for being here. Make sure that you do subscribe to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Turn on those notifications because whenever the season ends, we don't end. Oh, no. The NBA, it's a 365-day a year league. Then we get into the draft, which sounds like the Lakers are going to have their pick this year if the rumors are correct about the Pelicans and what they're going to do. So we'll get into draft picks. We'll get into trade possibilities, free agent signings, all that kind of stuff. Tons of stuff going on here on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel and the LakersNation.com podcast. So follow us over on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen to podcasts as well. All right, everybody. I appreciate all of you for joining again. Till next time, we'll see you and stay safe.